The Barack Obama from 1985 to 2002 in Illinois was a wonderful progressive politician. I'm a progressive Democrat myself.
Yes.
But the Barack Obama that we saw in the White House, whom we see nowadays, is a fundamentally different person from who he was in the 1990s.
And I happen to be a proponent of a single-payer universal health care plan. No reason why the United States of America, the wealthiest country in the history of the world, spending 14% of its gross national product on health care, cannot provide basic health insurance to everybody. And that's what Jim's talking about when he says everybody in, nobody out. You've got a situation here where not only is this basically a program that will do nothing to control costs and will do nothing to take money away from the big insurance companies and the drug companies because it does nothing to reform that system. It sets up a privatized system that will allow seniors to get dropped from a plan. And it's got a gap in coverage in addition to high deductibles and high premiums. It's got a gap in coverage.
When Barack was in Illinois, he was an outspoken proponent of single-payer health coverage, an outspoken critic of the Patriot Act and the intelligence community and the CIA. So the Obama that we have seen as president has been a dramatically different person. Up through 2002, Barack lived a very modest, humble, middle-class life. Now here we are in 2017 and we see him hobnobbing with celebrities and musicians and billionaires, getting $400,000 a speech. He's a very different person today from whom he was from 1985 through 2002.
There is a huge story out of Politico claiming that Barack Obama once said that if Bernie Sanders was running away with the nomination, that he would come out publicly and try to stop him. So this from Politico. Publicly, he's speaking of Obama, has been clear that he won't intervene in the primary for or against a candidate, unless he believed there was some egregious attack. Quote, I can't even imagine with this field how bad it would have to be for him to say something, said a close advisor. Instead, he sees his role as providing guardrails to keep the process from getting too ugly and to unite the party when the nominee is clear. There is one potential exception. Back when Sanders seemed like more of a threat than he does now, Obama said privately that if Bernie were running away with the nomination, Obama would speak up to stop him. Asked about that, a spokesperson for Obama pointed out that Obama recently said he would support and campaign for whoever the Democratic nominee is. Now, let's get to some other videos here. So, I covered this recently. This endorsement that Barack Obama gave to Bernie Sanders back in 2006. Let me show this because I think this kind of gives you a window into what both of these politicians were like back then and who's changed and who hasn't.
I think people are ready for a call to action. They want to move forward. They want to have honest leadership who cares about them, who thinks about them first, who isn't going down to Washington so that they can get a bunch of fancy steak dinners and have doors open for them and drive around in limousines and buy fancy suits, which you know you don't have to worry about with Bernie. Where do you get that suit, man? Right off the rack. That's not what they want. They want somebody who's going to fight for them. Somebody who's going to say, you know what? Let's have a prescription drug plan that's written on behalf of the people of America instead on behalf of the prescription drug companies. Why don't we try something like that? Let's have a budget that reflects our values and our priorities, that doesn't cut veteran spending, even as we claim to be patriotic, that doesn't end up cutting student loans at the same time as you say you want to promote higher education and increase competitiveness for the United States? How about an administration and a Congress that insists on a foreign policy that is both tough and smart? Since right now we've got a party that has the monopoly on the tough, dumb foreign policy strategy. That's what people are looking for. And they will find it in Bernie, and they'll find it in Peter. You will find it in these two gentlemen back here. And you don't have to take my word for it, because you know these guys. You've seen what they do.
So, I think it's pretty clear. Actually, a few things are clear from that video. It's a reminder of why Obama was so loved back then. I mean, this is a guy who is a talented politician, a fantastic orator. He and somebody who appeared to stand up for the average person. Now, one more video here. So, Bernie also, I mean, potentially, this could also lead to potentially the reason why Obama would be willing to do this. Bernie Sanders, back during Obama's administration, actually fought Obama publicly when Obama was threatening to cut Social Security. So check out this video.
Now, some of you may remember that when Barack Obama was running for president in 2008, he said that he would not cut Social Security. We want the president to remember what he said and not go back on his word. We are not going to balance the budget on the backs of the elderly, disabled vets, the sick, the women, or the children. When one out of four major profitable corporations pays nothing in federal income taxes, we know how we can deal with deficit reduction in a way that is fair. So what we want from the White House tells us that they want to defend the middle class. That's their mantra. Well, if you want to defend the middle class, you don't cut Social Security, and you don't cut Medicare, and you don't cut benefits for disabled vets. So our job in the coming weeks and months, and what today is about is the beginning of that job, is to rally tens of millions of people who understand that in this country, the middle class working families are hurting, and we're not going to balance the budget on their backs. Our job is to rally those people and give anybody in the Congress who believes in cutting these life-important benefits, we're going to give them a political choice they can't refuse. And that is, if they vote to cut Social Security, they may well not be returning to Washington. Thank you all very much.
Do you think he's a good person? He was certainly a very good person from 1985 till 2002. But the desire to succeed, the desire to win, the need to become president changed him, fundamentally changed him. And that, to me, is a fundamentally sad story.
Today, Barack Obama gave the good housekeeping seal of the president to the troubled waters of Flint, Michigan. And Jerika Duncan is there.
Can I get some water?
Before a crowd of 1,000.
I really did need a glass of water. This is not a stunt.
President Obama took a sip of Flint's filtered tap water, assuring the people there that he cares.
What? He wet his lips. He did not drink it. He didn't sip it. He wet his lips.
There was an audible gasp in the audience. People were just like absolutely dejected. Why would you do that?
I am sure that somewhere when I was 2 years old, I was taking a chip of paint, tasting it, and I got some lead.
Yeah, that's like talking about like, well, I didn't wear a seatbelt and I'm fine. It's like, but there were tons of people that died.
Backstage, the president sitting at the table with the criminal governor decided to perform his stunt
all over again.
You know, generally I have not been doing stunts here, but, you know.
That's not what I expected. That's right. What Snyder did.
It felt like he minimized, like, what people were actually going through and struggling with. If you were actually lead poisoned, you would not be president. You would be Janitor Barack Obama.
We were holding on to hope that he would declare a disaster area. A disaster would give us FEMA. It would give us pipe replacement, get engineers in here. Then we could get Medicare for all the residents of Flint. As soon as he took a drink of the water and said everything's fine, that was that.
And look at it, years later, it's still poison.
When he came here, he was my president, but when he left, he was not my president.
Senator from Illinois is recognized for 10 minutes.
And we can't afford to take a risk that the economy of the United States of America, and as a consequence, the worldwide economy, could be plunged into a very, very deep hole. So to Democrats and Republicans who've opposed this plan, I say, step up to the plate. Let's do what's right for the country at this time, because the time to act is now.
Mr. President, I strongly oppose this legislation. It takes our country in the wrong direction. It forces innocent taxpayers to bail out government policies and Wall Street mistakes. It asks the American people to take a leap of faith and trust people who have consistently misled them.
This bill does not deal with the absurdity of having the fox guarding the henhouse. Now, maybe I'm the only person in America who thinks so, but I have a hard time understanding why we are giving $700 billion to the Secretary of the Treasury, who was the former CEO of Goldman Sachs, who, along with other financial institutions, actually got us into this problem.
My biggest fear and the biggest problem I think we have in this country today is that people do not remember how bad things were. The panic, the anxiety.
It was the biggest thing since the Depression in the 1930s.
The number of homes facing foreclosure has jumped 57%.
This will be a time of anxiety for Americans worried about their mortgages and their homes.
Economists worry the housing slump will plunge the broader economy into a recession.
And let's do whatever it takes to keep the promise of America alive in our time.
I was always looking for that American dream. That's become an American nightmare.
We jumped through every single hoop that Wells Fargo threw at us, every time. Wells Fargo was saying they'd help. They were advertising you could get your mortgage amounts reduced if you refinanced. They said, send us this money and we'll rewrite your loan and make you a lower payment. And so Mitch borrowed the money and they cashed the check and they had our money, and I had 2 more weeks to get the rest of the monthly payment together. And I was ready to pay it when the deputy showed up on our door and told us they sold the house on the courtroom steps. And our next door neighbor had purchased our house. And the first thing I did was call the law office that was supposed to be helping us. And she said, don't answer the door. And I said, too late. Mitch has already gone out to meet him.
You know, after non-payment for so long, you know, they send the notices. If you don't pay, the threats, you know, if you don't pay, we're going to foreclose. If you don't pay, we're going to foreclose. We've started foreclosures. And then when you get served the paper from whatever sheriff or whoever that comes and brings you the paper that says you have to go to court, and then you go to court. And you have to bring your family and your kids in strollers.
Well, I think in the office, we all thought it was horrible. I mean, you know, nobody wants to take anything from anybody. If you're a decent person, you want that person to be whole. But you, if you're given a responsibility, your responsibility is to execute what the law says. And that's what being an administrative office. So here we are foreclosing. Here we have judges that feel the same way we do, and we're processing these loans. Now, some of the people, I was happy to see them, you know. But 90% of it, you know, is you just have to do it. That's, you know. And the people that got caught in the net that maybe shouldn't have, they had ample time, some of them, to get out if they could. But it's just a nasty business, and nobody feels good about that.
And the judge was so understanding. I think we were in and out probably in 15 minutes. I think he gave us 2 months to be out. You know, you could tell this was not his favorite day either. We had to walk away from everything. We couldn't pay the mortgage. We certainly couldn't pay credit cards. You know, we couldn't pay electricity. We couldn't pay water. You know, prior to the date of having to leave, you know, we spent a month in the house almost without electricity. Those were the worst days.
Our military bases are turning into refugee camps. I never thought I would see this in the United States of America. And we saw 3 children, younger than my kids, 7, 8, and 9, with their grandmother, mothers in Pennsylvania, all in tears crying. And I have to say, on a personal level, what an impact that had for me to see that just as a human.
And let's start with immigration. Donna, you heard what Rick Perry said about this. He said it's all about border security, and what the president has done is basically too little, too late.
But what is happening is a regional crisis, young people fleeing violence, abuse from, you know, Honduras, El Salvador.
Has that not been
Guatemala?
Going on for years and years?
Well,
and
it's
years
increased.
And years.
We had 6,500 kids probably about 3 years ago. Today it's close to 65, 70,000. It's growing. This is a crisis, a humanitarian crisis, and we have to resolve it. We cannot resolve it simply. And it's not just a crisis in the United States. It's also a crisis in Mexico, Panama, Costa Rica. These kids are fleeing violence, and they're looking for safety.
We're going to grow our economy. We're going to make our country more secure. We'll strengthen our families. And most importantly, we will live up. Most importantly, we will live up to our character as a nation. That's exactly what we're talking about.
Every single day.
That's why we're here.
Please use your executive order to halt deportation for all 11.5 undocumented immigrants in this country right now.
What we're trying.
We agree that we need to pass immigration reform. At the same time, you have a power to stop deportation for all undocumented immigrants.
Actually, I don't. And that's why we're here.
I need your help.
Okay.
Stop deportation.
Thank you. All right. What I'd like to do. No, don't worry about it, guys. Okay, let me finish.
This Congress has a 9% approval rating. Last I checked, it basically means their spouses don't think, their mothers don't think they're doing a good job, right?
This is a good.
So something's structurally wrong. I don't think we're going to get it.
Speaking of polls and speaking of approval rates, there was a poll out this week that generated a whole lot of attention. When asked who was the worst president since World War II, 33% said Obama, 28% said Bush, and Nixon came in with 13%. Donna, you want to start on that one?
Well, look, this president is in the moment. In the moment, 6 years, normally that's when the itch starts, the itch to find a new president. And I also believe that when you look at the poll and how it was conducted, not that I like to talk about the internal process of taking a poll, there's no question that the Democrats concentrated all of their efforts on one or two, and the Republicans said, yes, we dislike Obama.
In October 2015, The Intercept, an online publication devoted to reporting on whistleblowers like Edward Snowden, released a series entitled The Drone Papers. These were reportedly based on documents given to The Intercept by an intelligence agency whistleblower. Within them is a detailed examination of how the United States has used its drone program to assassinate suspected terrorists overseas, with disastrous consequences. So what exactly do the drone papers reveal? Well, the drone strike program was originally instituted under George W. Bush during the War on Terror. However, the Obama administration significantly increased the total number of drone strikes, particularly in Pakistan and Yemen. According to Obama, these strikes have been used exclusively against terrorists and with fewer civilian casualties than in missile strikes. But the most recent reports from the drone papers actually suggest that an overwhelming majority of deaths have indeed been civilian. In Afghanistan, a study found that pilotless drone strikes caused 10 times as many civilian deaths as did piloted planes. In fact, The Intercept found that out of 200 people killed in airstrikes, only 35 were the intended targets. The Intercept also discovered that the U.S. followed a policy of identifying those killed by drone strikes as enemies, until there was overwhelming proof that they were civilians. This method of concealing civilian deaths through omission was based on labeling all unidentified military-aged males as enemies killed in action. The way drone assassinations were processed came down to short character profiles printed on what were called baseball cards. These cards would include some personal information along with their apparent threat level. President Obama would spend, on average, 58 days deciding whether to authorize the assassination. But perhaps the most damaging aspect of the drone program was the preference to kill combatants instead of capturing them. In a speech justifying drone strikes in 2013, President Obama explained that it was sometimes impossible to capture terrorists before they could...
A report by Human Rights Watch claims that a December drone strike in Yemen might have violated rules that President Obama himself set to regulate their use. At least 12 people were killed in a strike that was carried out by the U.S. military's Joint Special Operations Command. The first reports about the strike claimed that it was a wedding procession full of civilians who were killed. No, 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 the military said. It was an al-Qaeda group. But then the military backtracked after human rights groups started digging into the story. And then it acknowledged that it was a wedding procession after all that was hit. However, the military says that it was most of the people that actually died were in fact al-Qaeda militants that were in that procession. But here's what the new report says. It says Human Rights Watch found the convoy was indeed a wedding procession that was bringing the bride and family members to the groom's hometown. The procession also may have included members of AQAP, also known as Al-Qaeda of the Arabian Peninsula, although it is not clear who they were or what was their fate. The report went on to say Human Rights Watch found no evidence, and the Obama administration has provided none, that the individuals taking part in the wedding procession posed an imminent threat to life.
I came in with a healthy skepticism about these programs. My team evaluated them. We scrubbed them thoroughly. We actually expanded some of the oversight, increased some of the safeguards. But my assessment and my team's assessment was that they help us prevent terrorist attacks. You can't have 100% security and also then have 100% privacy and zero inconvenience. We're going to have to make some choices as a society. And what I can say is that in evaluating these programs, they make a difference in our capacity to anticipate and prevent possible terrorist activity. In the abstract, you can complain about Big Brother and how this is a potential program run amok. But when you actually look at the details, then I think we've struck the right balance.
Slithers through Washington. Here now, Joe Borelli, former Trump campaign co-chair for New York State, and Blake Rutherford, Democratic strategist. Okay, you just heard from Elizabeth Warren, Blake. And even Bernie Sanders, he called this unfortunate that Barack Obama is accepting a 400G payday. Are you stunned, Blake?
I'm not stunned. I think we need to take a step back and remember that in 2008,
Barack Obama received more Wall Street contributions than any other candidate, and then what followed was Dodd-Frank and financial regulatory reform.
True.
He's been pretty tough on Wall Street. And remember, this money goes for a speech that's going to be at a health care conference. Certainly an issue that we're talking about today as we continue to see the Republicans struggle on fulfilling their six-year promise to repeal the Affordable Care Act. So I'm certainly not stunned. He's not the first ex-president to accept speaking fees, and he won't be the last.
It was revealed last week that Barack Obama would speak out against Bernie if it looked like Bernie was going to run away with it and get the nomination.
You're never going to, you know, this idea of purity, and you're never compromised, and you're always politically woke and all that stuff. You should get over that quickly. The world is messy. There are ambiguities. People who do really good stuff have flaws. People who you are fighting may love their kids. And, you know, share certain things with you.
Now, this story proves two things. Number one, Obama actually self-identifies as a centrist status quo manager, that he understands that that's his role. So all the progressive talk on the campaign trail where he was acting like he was further left than he is, he knows that was just a charade. He knows that was just an act. He knows that was just what he does on the campaign trail to then get in office and then get serious about the job of being president. That's the first thing. The second thing is, now everybody's talking about the first thing and everybody understands that. The second point, which I haven't heard many people talk about, which I also think is indisputably correct, is that he's terrified that in a situation where Bernie wins, Bernie's legacy would dwarf his and put his in historical perspective. And then history wouldn't look so kindly on his legacy. And he's terrified of that. So the takeaway there is, in my estimation, I think that Barack Obama cares way more about his legacy and the respect he wants on his name than he cares about actually fixing our terrible, disgusting, broken system. Remember, guys, it was just a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago, where we covered a story where apparently Obama's team, and they were saying this out loud as if, like, you know, like, I don't get it. Why is this the case? They were saying, I don't understand why healthcare is like one of the top things that all these candidates are running on. I don't understand why so many candidates are seemingly pushing for Medicare for All. Now, at this point, it's, you know, pretty much only Bernie who's really never wavered even a little bit on that. But they're amazed that healthcare is center stage. Why? Because in their mind, they go, "What? We wasted a lot of political capital and we got Obamacare through. And so, like, that's check. Next, moving on." And isn't that so indicative of one of the many problems with Obama and his administration and his team? Is that they think, like, well, that's enough. We did as good as we possibly could on that front. Same idea with Dodd-Frank. Dodd-Frank comes along, and it is a watered-down half-measure which doesn't address the core problem which led to the subprime mortgage crisis and the Great Recession. It doesn't even bring back Glass-Steagall, which is absolutely necessary if you want to avert the next crash. And now they're looking around like, I don't understand. Why is Wall Street reform still a topic and regulation still a topic that people are talking about? We already did Dodd-Frank. But you're only doing the reform in name. You're doing these terrible half measures which are completely ineffectual and don't get to the root problem, and then you're surprised when we have to go back and address it again. In the case of healthcare, yes, he gets partial credit because Obamacare, even though it wasn't the best kind of reform, in fact, it was one of the worst kinds of reforms, at least it covered millions more people. Congratulations. It covered, did protections for pre-existing conditions. That's a good thing. Congratulations. Let's kids stay on their parents' rolls until they're 26 years old. Congratulations. That's all wonderful stuff. But we still have 500,000 bankruptcies from medical bills. We still have tens of millions who are uninsured. We still have deaths from people not being able to get basic health care, 30 to 45,000 a year. So, and on top of that, Obamacare perpetually polled around 50%, sometimes less, sometimes just over. And when you have a reform that's consistently on wobbly baby deer legs, it's easy for the opposition to come in and gut it. And that's exactly what happened. And that's exactly what Trump did. And so in Trump's first term, at least 7 million people have now lost their health insurance. Now, some might argue, well, listen, no matter what reform you do, they would stab it in the back. History tells us it's a lot harder to stab in the back a strong universal proposal, because a strong universal proposal has a much higher favorability rating. And then they know it's political suicide to directly go at a strong universal program. So it would definitely weather the test of time and the right-wing onslaught much better. Listen, this is the truth about Obama. You have to be honest. Are there good things he did? Absolutely. The Iran deal was wonderful. You know, unfortunately, that was also stabbed in the back by Trump and the Republicans. Freeing the nonviolent drug offenders, which he did, many of them, in his second term in office. That was wonderful. There are a bunch of things I could point to where I say, good job, way better than your standard Republican, no doubt. But Obama himself has described his own ideology as that of a moderate Republican, that of an old-school moderate Republican. And now you see that when you're presented with an actual lefty like Bernie Sanders, who's calling to do basic lefty things, FDR-style New Deal liberalism. And he's like, what? Why would you do such things? I would have to speak out against him if it looks like he's going to win. The first time Obama was in the news after his presidency, what was it? Do you guys remember? Going jet skiing with billionaire Richard Branson. And then the next time was giving Wall Street speeches for about $500,000 a pop. It turns out that when the guy bails out Wall Street to the tune of $14 trillion, they look at him kind of favorably when he doesn't prosecute bankers who need to be prosecuted. They're like, oh, that's our boy. We may have had hard feelings when we were in there, but ultimately he looked out for us. That's our boy. So he self-identifies as a moderate Republican. His policies act like that of a moderate Republican. And now some people are surprised that, oh my God, he's against Bernie? What? Yes, he is. Now, I don't know how direct he would be in denouncing Bernie. Is it possible what he would do is not mention Bernie at all, but throw an endorsement behind one of the corporate Democrats, whoever it might be? Mayor Pete, Deval Patrick, Michael Bloomberg, Amy Klobuchar. Is it possible he would do something like that? Joe Biden, he hasn't endorsed, and it looks like he won't endorse him. It's possible he would do something like that. Or it's possible he's more direct. But my guess is, in a typical Obama fashion, he would play hide the ball a little bit, and he wouldn't be totally upfront. And so he wouldn't just flat out say, like, I'm against Bernie becoming the nominee. Because he wants to leave himself wiggle room so that if his attempt to stop Bernie doesn't work, he could turn around and say, I wasn't even trying to stop Bernie. I don't know what you guys are talking about. I was just saying that my favorite candidate was one of the centrists. That's all I was saying. So I don't know how direct he would have been, but I'm not surprised that this is the way he feels.